you all for coming here today evening. And I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you. So I'll speak about the Bhagavad Gita's understanding of who we are and what the nature of reality is. When we observe the world, we say that some people are more rational, some people are more emotional. And sometimes we consider rationality more important than emotionality. And it is true, sometimes when we become too emotional, we may take decisions that are not very sound. At the same time, for us, in the normal perception of things, for the normal functioning, both the rational and the emotional aspects are important. So if the rational side becomes too strong, or if the emotional side becomes too strong, if the emotional side becomes too strong, we get carried away by our emotions and act foolishly. But if the rational side becomes too strong and one doesn't have any emotions at all, that can also be dangerous. If there are people who are psychopaths or sociopaths, so they can heartlessly hurt others and kill others, and they don't feel anything at all. So to be deadened to emotions is unhealthy, and to be deadened to reason is also unhealthy. And the same principle applies in not just perceiving in this world, but also approaching the absolute truth. So when I talk about unity in diversity and then diversity in unity, I'm going to talk about how when we approach the nature of reality, when we look at things rationally, then we try to find the commonality underlying the diversity. So for example, if we are looking at a beautiful rose. Now I can look at a rose from an aesthetic perspective, and I can appreciate, hey, this is such a beautiful color, such an exquisite shape, such a charming fragrance. And I can look at the same rose from an analytical perspective. I can look at the rose as a botanist. Say, okay, this is a carpel, this is andrusium, this is the gynoecium, these are the stamen, these flowers are this big, this pollination has happened, this has not happened. Now, both perspectives are valid. Now, depending on what I am looking for, if I am offering the rose as a representation of, say, affection or respect to someone, and then they take the perspective of a botanist, that will be a mismatch. On the other hand, if somebody is in a scientific laboratory, and they have to study a rose. And at that time, you have to dissect maybe pull the rose apart and look at its petals, look at its various things. Hey, this rose is so beautiful. I don't want to hurt it. Well, then you won't be able to study botany. So in different situations, different approaches are required. The same applies to the nature of reality. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the 10th chapter, verses 8 to 11 are called the Chatur Shloki Gita. They refer to the four verses which convey in essence the message of the Gita. So the first verse there is Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo Mattah Sarvam Pravartate Iti Matva Bhajante Maam Buddha Bhava Samanvitah. So Krishna says Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo, that I am the source of everything. Mattah sarvam pravartate, by me everything is sustained. Iti matva, those who understand this, what happens to them? Bhajante maam, they start worshipping me. How? Buddha, they have become wise. The word Buddha is cognate with the word Buddha. Normally we consider the word Buddha to refer to a historical personality who founded Buddhism. But Buddha generically refers to an enlightened person. So those who understand the absolute to be the source of everything, they have become wise, Buddha. And what do? Bhava samanvitaha, with the emotions of their heart, they bhajante mam, they worship. So here Krishna is saying in the Bhagavad Gita that when there is perfect knowledge and there is complete knowledge, there is a harmony of the head and the heart. The head understands the nature of reality and the heart is in tune with that understanding in a mood of loving devotion. It's interesting that the Bhagavad Gita is spoken at a time when there is a great crisis. A war is about to start. And at that time, the conches are blown, indicating the starting of hostilities. And then at that time, Arjuna says to Krishna, Senayor Bhayor Madhye Ratham Sthapayame Achyuta. O Krishna, please place our chariot in between the two armies. I want to see who is there out there. Kairmayasa Yodhavyam Asmin Rana Samudyame. Who all are there here? I want to see that. And then he sees and then he gets overwhelmed. He starts crying. And then they start talking. And they keep talking. And they keep talking. And the conversation that they have is the Bhagavad Gita. Now, to understand the unusualness of this setting, consider the event which arouses probably the maximum emotion among Indians. Say a cricket match, say a World Cup final between India and Pakistan. There are thousands and thousands of people in the stadium, there are millions of people watching TV, and say the fielders are in that position, the toss has already been done, the batsmen have walked out, the bowler is about to, in the action, to bowl. At that time, the striker calls the non-striker and they start talking. And they keep talking. And they keep talking. Everybody is restless. They go on talking and talking and talking. Now there are some players who do gamesmanship. That means if the match is going against them, then they will try to slow down the tempo, break the momentum of the opposition so that they can gain an advantage. But if we know that these two players are good players, they are sportsmanly, they're not going to do gamesmanship, then everybody will be curious, what are they talking about? So, similar is the situation when both the armies are assembled, everybody has taken out their bow and arrow, they're ready to fight, and at that time, Krishna and Arjuna start talking. So, at that time, what has happened? Arjuna has become overwhelmed by emotions. He starts thinking, how can I fight in this war? How can I fight against my relatives, my elders? And when he's overwhelmed by emotion, at that time, he asks a question. First, he says, I don't know what to do. Na chaitad vidmah katarannu gariyo yadva jaye mayadivano jayeyu yane vahatvana jijivishamas devastata pramukhe dhartha rashtra. In 2.6, he says that, should I fight and win? But then, my loved ones will die. Should I just avoid the fight? But then, we will all be labeled as coward, we will be paupers, we'll have to live in the forest, we'll have nothing. We'll be disgraced as being cowardly, having fled the battle. Should I stay and fight half-heartedly? But then, my other family members will die. I will also die. So, he just can't see what to do at that time. Intelligence can have many conceptions or definitions. One definition of intelligence is to know what to do when you don't know what to do. To know what to do when we don't know what to do. That means, say if a child is trying to do something and can't figure out what to do, what does the child do? Child goes to the mother, goes to the father. So if we are taking some treatment and we find that it has some side effect which is unexpected, what do? We don't know what to do, so we go to a doctor at that time. So similarly, at this point, Arjuna says, I don't know what to do, but then he does something. The next verse, he surrenders to Krishna. Karpanya dosho pahata swabhava पृच्छामि त्वां धर्म सम्मूढचेतः श्रेयस्यान्निश्चितं ब्रूहि तन्मे शिष्यस्तेऽहं शाधि मां त्वां प्रपन्नं. So I surrender to you as your disciple. Please tell me, what is dharma? What is the right course of action for me? So all of us come to situations in our life, sometime or the other, when we just don't know what to do. Should I do this? But the prospect with this is bleak. Should I do that? The prospect with that also is bleak. So what should I do? That is the question. So this question is not simply, should I fight or should I not fight? This question is, I want to know about dharma. And this universal question makes the Bhagavad Gita's message universal. If it had been simply about whether I should fight a particular war or not, then that would have been just simply of some historical interest to some people. But the question is universal. What is the right course of action? And Krishna says, the right course of action requires the right understanding of reality. And then he proceeds to give the right understanding of reality. So he says that beyond the physical, which we see, is the spiritual. And spiritual is the higher or the greater level of reality. And first he talks about, he shifts the vision from the body to the soul. That inside the body is the dehinosmin yatha dehe. That is the owner of the body. That is the consciousness. That is the energy of the soul, the Atma. And then after fixing the vision on the Atma, he moves the vision further, especially from the 6th chapter onwards, to the Paramatma. He says there is another being inside. And then most of the Gita thereafter is about understanding the relationship between the Atma and the Paramatma. Who we are, what the nature of reality is, and how are we to harmonize with that. Suppose, say, there is a drama and there are some kids who are practicing for the drama. They want to do the performance of the drama. And say a kid does very good rehearsals, very good practice, and they go on the stage. But when they start playing the drama, they start playing their role in the drama, nothing seems to make sense to them. No, everybody else seems to be doing something else. And although this kid is doing the drama very well, everybody else is looking strangely at them. And they keep going through the drama. Then they understand, actually, the drama which he or she had prepared for is different from the drama that is being enacted. So that drama was rescheduled and that is later. So now they just barged in and they are playing in some other drama only. So, you know, before we can play our part, we have to know the play of which we are a part. So similarly, we all have our part in the world. We are all meant to do something in life. But what play are we a part of? So that bigger picture is what the Bhagavad Gita gives. And most of the Bhagavad Gita talks about how do we understand the bigger picture and what is the nature of the reality that is revealed when we see the bigger picture. So there are, broadly speaking, two conceptions. When we look at the world around us, we look, there is so much diversity. See, every one of us is wearing a different kind of dress, different color. All of us have our different looks. Even in this room, we can see there are so many different objects. So the sheer diversity of the world can be overwhelming. So when we see this overwhelming amount of sensory input that comes into us, we try to process it by categorizing. So categorizing maybe, okay, these are males, these are females, these are kids, these are adults, these are Indians, these are Americans. So when we are categorizing, what are we trying to do? There is so much diversity, we are trying to bring some unity in it. Okay, there are 25 people over here. Okay, 15 are female, 10 are male, something like that. So this is diversity. in the diversity, by putting some category, we are bringing some unity. And as we go deeper, I say, okay, yeah, there are females, there are males, there are adults, there are kids, but they are all human beings. So as we go deeper and deeper into the categorization, the more fundamental level, we try to come to unity. Okay, there is oneness. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, as our knowledge pursues higher and higher, we move from diversity towards unity. In the 18th chapter, in the 20th text, he says that Sarvabhuteshu yenaikam bhavam avyayam ikshate avibhaktam vibhakteshu tadjnanam vidhisatvikam. He says Sarvabhuteshu, they're all different living beings and they all have their different varieties. But in among all of them, there is one nature. Bhavam avyayam ikshate, one imperishable nature. One who sees this, such a person is seeing in Sattva Guna, in the mode of goodness. Their vision is advanced. So we also nowadays have the idea of inclusivism. Yeah, there are different people, different races, different nationalities, different cultures. But let's focus on the fact that we are all human beings. See the commonality. So in diversity language, they say, see the brother in the other. Don't see the other as someone different. See that they're also like us, they're related to us. So by the systematic analysis of reality, a systematic observation of reality, we go down from diversity to unity. Okay, we try to categorize, and through categorizing, going fundamental down, do we come to unity. So similarly, when this vision is applied to the absolute truth, at that time, we look at the huge variety. Okay, there are trees, there is earth, there is sky, there are planets. So what is all this? How do we categorize? If we look at the various celestial objects, we say, okay, some are stars, some are planets. We categorize like that. But as we categorize and we try to look at the unity that thinkers find and which Bhagavad Gita tells is that everything is part of one absolute truth. So there can be evolution in the conception of reality. So if we consider the ultimate reality, there are atheists who say there is no God. So that could be preliminary. They look at the world around and say, I don't see any God anywhere. Where is it? There's nothing anywhere. So now some of you may be managers in companies. Now you know that a good management system means that everything should work well without the manager requiring constant intervention. And the less the intervention of the manager is required, the better is the management system. So, yes, this world is managed so well that we don't see the manager at all. But not seeing the manager, some people may start thinking there is no manager only. But it's not like that. So to see that there is no God is a very preliminary level of perception. From there, people may say there's so much different variety. Oh, there is the sky, there is the earth, there are the planets. So from there is no God, some people may evolve to there are many gods. There are so many diverse phenomena and they are all controlled by different powerful agents. Then from that place, one may evolve. Yes, there may be many different, but there will be chaos if there is not some cooperation. If there are in a big company, there are many departments, but there's no authority who unifies those departments, there'll be chaos. So from there, one may evolve further. And we say there is only one God. So there's no God, there are many gods, there is one God. Now this is broadly seen as the understanding. So there are polytheistic religions which say there are many gods. And many of the monotheistic religions, they say that they are proud. You know, we believe in only one God. This polytheism is very primitive. Now, the Bhagavad Gita actually acknowledges these various ideas. At one level, one may see no God because one may have a short-sighted perspective. One may perceive many gods. That's also one level of perception. Then, one may perceive one God. And then, there can be... So when we see one God, when there is one God and there is this world. But then one can have another level of perception also. that level of perception is that there is only God. There is only God. Bahunam janmanamante jnanavan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sudurlabha vasudeva sarvamiti. God is everything. So now when they say God is everything, this is the vision of oneness. In the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about how we can see Him in everything. And there when He says, among the mountains, I am the tallest mountain. Among the oceans, I am the biggest ocean. So, here Krishna is telling us that whatever attractive things in this world we see, where does their attractiveness come from? It comes from Him. So there in the 10th chapter, in the last part, He says, Pandavanam aham dhananjaya. Among the Pandavas, I am Dhananjaya. I am Arjuna. It's initially when Arjuna hears Pandavanam aham. He says, among the Pandavas, Yudhishthira is considered the most virtuous. He says, surely he will say Yudhishthira. But he doesn't say, I am Yudhishthira. He says, I am Arjuna. I am Dhananjaya. Because there is a very affectionate bond between the two. And Arjuna has both dharma and bhakti. So, but it's interesting when Krishna tells Arjuna that among the Pandavas, I am Dhananjaya. So Arjuna doesn't say, oh Krishna, that means we two are one. And if both of us are one, there's no need for you to speak Bhagavad Gita. Say, whatever you know, I know, we two are one. So Arjuna doesn't say that. So there is oneness. So as I said, we move from diversity towards unity to make sense of the categorization. So there are no God, many gods, one God, only God. So Vasudeva Sarvagati is accepted. But that oneness is also seen in different ways. The Vedantic school of thought accepts that there is the oneness of the Absolute. But then there are questions about what is the nature of that oneness. Is it absolute non-differentiated oneness? Or is it oneness with some variegatedness in it? In the Ramayana, when Ram is exiled to the forest, at that time Lakshman is furious. He feels a great injustice has been done against Ram. And he protests vehemently. But when Ram insists, I am going to go to the forest, Lakshman also goes with him. When they are living in Chitrakoot, Chitrakoot Adriniketan Rama, on top of Chitrakoot they are there. At that time, suddenly, they hear some loud, disturbing sound in the nearby forest. It appears as if some great creature or a great procession is coming. Then Lakshman climbs on top of a tree and they see an army over there. And as he peers, trying to identify, what is that army? And he says, actually, that is the army of Ayodhya. And he sees Bharat at the head. And as soon as Lakshman sees this, he becomes furious. He says, that wicked son of that wicked Kaikeyi, he's not satisfied after having sent you to the forest. Now he has come with the whole army to kill you. But he doesn't know that I stand between you and him. Today he and all those whom he supports will meet death at the hands of my arrows. He's seething in anger. Ram at that time is very calm. And he says, oh Lakshman, why are you so angry? I know Bharat, and Bharat's love for me is no lesser than your love for me. Is it that in a rush of emotion, you decided to come with me to the forest? But now, on experiencing the austerity of the forest, you are finding it unbearable. And because of the austerity of the forest being unbearable, you are getting angry and you are feeling angry with Bharat. If that is the case, then when Bharat reaches here, I will tell him to stay in the forest and you can go back and you can be the king. Now when Ram speaking all this, Lakshman's anger is going down. When finally Hari says, you can go back over there. So Lakshman becomes completely deflated. And then finally, when he comes back, when Bharat comes and he sees how selfless is the love of Bharat for Ram. Many times when a wealthy patriarch passes away, often their children, they fight bitterly for the inheritance. There are succession battles. Similarly, after Dashrath's passing away, there is succession battle between Ram and Bharat. But normal succession battles are, I want this. But here the battle was, you take it. Both of them are arguing, you take it. They both of them trying to give reasons. And finally, Bharat says, please give me your paduka. Please touch these sandals. And then Ram, seeing his devotion, agrees. Today, if one brother gave his sandals to the other brother, the other brother would take the sandals and beat his brother with it. So, such is the selflessness of Bharat's love that he takes the sandal on his head and he goes back. And the sandals sit on the throne and he sits on a lower seat at the feet of the throne. So he wants to show to the world through this external position the disposition of his heart. That Ram is the king and I am his servant. Now after seeing all this, Lakshman's heart gets profoundly remorseful. And then he says, when Ram and Lakshman are talking, he says, no Ram, why do I get angry so quickly? So then Ram says, this pats him, elder brother, tum bahut bhavuk ho. You are very sentimental. You are very emotional. Then Lakshman becomes pensive and he says, are emotions bad? So Ram says, no, emotions are not bad. He says, emotions are the ornaments of life. It is emotions that bring joy to life. But we need to choose the emotions that lift us up and avoid the emotions that drag us down. We need to choose the emotions that inspire us towards dharma. And we need to avoid the emotions that take us away from dharma. So emotions can be a help and they can be an obstacle based on time, place, circumstance. So when a mother loves a child, at that time, the mother has to have some emotion in the way she interacts with the child. But if a surgeon is operating a child, at that time, emotions may come in the way. So now, going in the same way, when we approach the absolute, I was talking about this emotions and how we need to choose the emotions that lift us up and not take us down. I took the story to illustrate the same point that when we approach the absolute truth also, we have to approach in a way that is both intellectually appealing and emotionally fulfilling. So the idea of categorizing and reducing the category till we come to oneness. That there is the idea of absolute oneness seems intellectually appealing. Yes, you know, we are all one. But what is the nature of this oneness? If you say that the nature of that oneness, if it is absolutized, what that would mean is, right now, say all of you are hearing this class. So then, here there is the subject of consciousness and there's the object of consciousness. So say, I am looking at you, you are looking at me. So if you are looking at me, you are the subject who is observing. And you are looking at me, so I am the object who is being observed. And linking both of us is the stream of consciousness. It's the subject of consciousness, the object of consciousness and the stream of consciousness. Those three things are there. Now, absolute oneness would mean that there is no subject and there is no object. There is only the stream of consciousness. Now, if there is stream of consciousness, what will that stream be conscious of? And who is it that is conscious? There is nothing to be conscious of, and there is no one to be conscious. So in the state of non-differentiated oneness or absolute oneness, what will happen is that the only thing to think is that there is nothing to think. The only thing to do is that there is nothing to do. The only thing that exists has nothing to be aware of. Now, this conception is lacking in any emotional content. And if we look at the world and we understand the world has come from the absolute, then whatever is present here must be present in the absolute. Otherwise, this world would turn out to be bigger than the source. So if the world is greater than God, then how is God the source of everything? How is God the greatest being? So whatever is present here needs to be present in the absolute truth also. So that is, so if I look at fire from one perspective, there's a candle over here, you can see these candles, you can see there's fire. From one perspective, there's one flame. But then, if I look from another perspective, in the fire there is heat, there is light, and actually when I see the fire, what is happening is the wick is burning and flames are coming. So what appears to be one flame is actually a continuous change of the wick of the candle burning and the flame appearing and going. So the same thing which appears one from one perspective, from another perspective, can be seen as having many more layers of complexity within it. Similarly, the Bhagavad Gita says that Vasudeva Sarvamiti, Vasudev is everything. Now, what is illusion? I'll conclude with 2 points. I don't want to make this class too philosophical, but 2 points. Illusion, as the Bhagavad Gita tells us, is different from illusion as we may normally think. Sometimes we say, if I am in a desert and I see a mirage, to see that there is only sand, but I see water. That is illusion. So that is illusion in perception. Perception means the way I am seeing things with my senses is wrong. That's illusion in perception. But Maya, which is illusion, which is what the Bhagavad Gita says, the divine illusion, Mama Maya Duratya, that is not illusion in perception. It can be a part of it, but the essence of Maya is illusion in conception. Conception means not just how I am seeing things externally, how the appearance is coming into my eyes, but what is my conception, what is my worldview. So what is Maya? The Bhagavatam says, Rute artham yat pratiyeta na pratiyeta chatmani tam vidyadatmano maya yatha bhaso yatha tamaha. That means to see anything disconnected from the absolute, that is Maya. So the absolute exists, things exist, and there is an integral connection between all of them. To see anything disconnected from the absolute is what is Maya. So Ravana, he saw Sita. Sita's beauty is real, Sita is real. Ravana is real, Ram is real. What is unreal is Ravana seeing Sita separate from Ram. Ravana saying that Sita is meant for my enjoyment. That was the fatal blunder which caused his destruction. So reality, so illusion is, the fundamental nature of illusion is illusion in conception. So when we see everything as connected with the whole, everything as meant for the service of the whole, everything meant for a loving reunion with the whole, then that is the oneness that is both intellectually and emotionally fulfilling. What does this mean, intellectually and emotionally fulfilling? We see beyond the categories of this world to the one, beyond the diversity of this world to the oneness. There is unity, there is oneness. Within that oneness, there is variety. It's like sometimes if the lights go off, it's extremely dark, we can't see anything. There can be a darkness which causes blindness. But sometimes if you are driving a car and suddenly some big truck comes along and they glare, then the brightness can also cause blindness. But initially all that we see is just brightness, we just see the light. But then after our eyes get accustomed to the brightness, okay, there's one truck over here and there's another vehicle behind over there. And there's a car over here. Okay, I cannot go right now. I'll have to slow down, I have to stop. So blindness can be caused by darkness, and blindness can be caused even by brightness. So in the material world, blindness is caused by darkness. That means we identify ourselves with matter and we get caught in the world of matter, not perceiving any higher reality. When we come to the spiritual level, we see the oneness of the absolute. But that oneness can itself be so bright that it can be blinding. Hiranmayena patrena satyasyapihitam mukham tattvam pushana pavrunu satyadharmaya drishtaye. In the Ishopanishad said that, my dear Lord, please remove, O absolute truth, please remove your blinding effulgence so that I can see the nature of reality, so that I can understand you in your true manifestation. So yes, beyond the variety of this world is the oneness of spiritual reality. And in the oneness of spiritual reality, there is the variety that is pure and spiritual. And in that variety, there is God, Krishna, who exists as supreme reality. And there are many, many souls who are lovingly connected with Krishna. And that world of pure devotion is the world where God doesn't reign supreme. That is the world where love reigns supreme. So the love reigns supreme means that God doesn't act as if he is God all the time. One of my friends is a high court judge, and he told me once that, you know, judge, he likes to be a judge, but still being a judge is his job. He said, if I had to be a judge for the rest of eternity, my life would be miserable. So he says, if God is simply a judge for everyone, then God's job would be boring. God's job would be miserable, actually. So he says, God is much more than, say, observer of the world, overseer of the world. God has his own life beyond this world. And in that world, he doesn't delight in his godhood. I am God, you bow down to me. There is oneness in love. And that oneness of love is so great that the devotee forgets that Krishna is God, and Krishna also forgets that he is God. All that happens is there is simply the joy of love. In the 10th canto of the Bhagavat, there is a story of many pastimes of Krishna, in which there is a story of the Ras Leela, in which Krishna and the gopis meet in the forest of Vrindavan. And at one time, Krishna disappears from among them. And when Krishna disappears, all the gopis are searching for him desperately. They're searching, searching, searching. And Krishna wants to see the intensity of their love. So as he wants to see the intensity of their love, at that time, the gopis are searching, and he appears in the distance. But he appears in the form of Vishnu. And as he appears in the form of Vishnu, at that time, he has four hands, Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma are there with him. And the gopis come running. Initially from the distance, they see Krishna's complexion and Vishnu's complexion are the same. Oh, we all found Krishna. They come running. And when they come and see it is Vishnu, they are disappointed. The great yogis, they are delighted to get one glimpse of Krishna, of Vishnu also. And they are ready to perform tapasya for a long, long time. When the gopis see Krishna, they are disappointed. And they offer their respects to Vishnu and they say, oh Vishnu, please, oh Lord Vishnu, you are all pervading, you are all knowing. Please tell us, where is Krishna? And Krishna sees the love of the gopis, he is very touched by that. He points with his finger this way. And the gopis offer their prospects and they just run away in that direction. And then finally, among all the gopis, the gopi with the greatest devotion is Radharani. So she comes there. As Radharani comes there, she looks at Krishna. She looks at Vishnu. She offers his respects. Oh Lord Vishnu, please tell me, where is my Krishna? And as she's asking with such intensity, Krishna again wants to point his hands. But what happens? The intensity of her love, the desperation with which she is looking for Krishna, that causes Krishna's two hands to melt away. And he wants to point out, but he has no hand to point over there. And then Radharani sees the Lord of her heart in front of her. So here what has happened? Krishna forgets his godhood because of the love of Radharani. And the gopis forget Vishnu's godhood because of the love of Krishna. Yes, Vishnu is God, but our Lord is Krishna. We want to go to Krishna. So in the spiritual world, love reigns supreme. Krishna doesn't act as God. He acts simply as the lover of his devotees. And the devotees treat him as their eternal Lord. And in that reciprocation, there is the highest fulfillment of the heart. Because Krishna, he is sarva akarshak. He is all attractive. And he loves every soul. There's a beautiful story in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, where there is a Gopakumar, there's a seeker from this world who goes through various spiritual adventures. And finally, he comes to the spiritual world. When he finally attains the spiritual world, so Krishna is going out with his cowherd, Gopas, to herd the cows. And suddenly he sees this Gopakumar. Krishna is so delighted on seeing him. Krishna runs up to hug him. And Krishna is so excited that Krishna faints. So seeing the Gopakumar in the spiritual world, Krishna loses his Krishna consciousness. Krishna just loses. And then all the gopas turn to him and they say that, you know, who is this boy? What has he done to our Krishna? And he says, hey, I didn't do anything. I don't know what happened. And then Krishna, normally fainting, we can say it's being overwhelmed by emotion or being overwhelmed by weakness. Generally, when do we faint? Normally, either it is because of extreme health weakness or it is because we are experiencing emotions of such intensity that the body cannot sustain those emotions. So the defense mechanism of the body is that the body switches off. So Krishna, he experiences such intense joy on seeing the Gopakumar that he faints. And then when he comes back to consciousness, Krishna says, Oh Gopakumar, oh my dear friend, you know, for so many lifetimes you're away from me. I was longing for you to come and be with me. I'm so delighted that you're back with me. Now, never go away from me. Stay with me forever. And he pulls him into a tight, long hug. So that hug represents the pinnacle of oneness. That oneness is the oneness of pure love. Where God exists, the soul exists, but God is not aware of his godhood, the soul is not aware of God's godhood. All that is present is love. So the oneness is not oneness where there is no one to reciprocate love. The oneness is that where there is no one to interrupt love. There is not even the awareness of God's godhood to interrupt love. Everything that is there in the spiritual world, in Krishna's abode, is simply meant for the reciprocation of love. And this diversity, that there is God and there is soul, this is what enables the love to happen. So all this is in the platform of ultimate reality. And this diversity in unity is what brings ecstasy in eternity. Eternity already exists. The ecstasy comes because there is eternal loving reciprocation between the soul and the absolute. So I'll summarize what I spoke. I spoke on the topic of unity in diversity and diversity in unity. I started by talking about how when we, in the normal functioning in life, we need our rationality so that we can pursue objectively and not be carried away by our emotions. But we also need our emotionality so that we don't become heartless and we don't perceive things holistically. So in the Bhagavad Gita, at the start, Arjuna becomes overwhelmed by emotions and he can't perceive. Like at the start of a cricket match, World Cup final, two players, two batsmen just start talking with each other. So that, what is that conversation about? It is not just about whether I should fight or not fight. It is about what is my duty? What is the right course of action? And for understanding the right course of action, Krishna tells Arjuna that you have to understand what, you have to have a right understanding of reality. And that right understanding of reality begins with understanding that underlying the physical is the spiritual. That we are at our core souls. And the soul is beyond the soul is a supreme soul. And what is the nature of the soul and the super soul? Krishna says that when one knows him in truth, then that person becomes enlightened, Buddha. But then also, bhava samanmitaha bhajante. With emotions, he surrenders. With all the emotions of his heart, he worships me. So there is the head and the heart which are harmonized there. So we discussed the need of the head is to look for some unity amidst the diversity of the world. Now, if every person is entirely different and there is no categorization to make sense of it, we will get intellectually overwhelmed by the load of processing all the information. So we categorize. Okay, men, women, adults, kids, Indians, Americans. So we reduce the diversity to some manageable level of diversity. And if you go deeper, that diversity also reduced to unity, that's humanity. Similarly, when we look at the world around us, there's so much diversity. But the diversity can all be reduced down to some unity. So that could be there is no God. Or it could be there are many gods. All diverse phenomena are controlled by certain beings. But beyond that, there has to be one supreme. There is one God. And then there is only God. Now, that God is all that exists. Vasudeva Sarvamiti, the Bhagavad Gita says. But what does that mean? Does that mean that no one exists apart from God? No. What it means is that we all are parts of God. Illusion means that we see ourselves as separate from God. Illusion in perception means to see things wrongly. But illusion in conception means to have a notion which makes us which see things wrongly. So, to see everything connected with the Absolute is the vision of reality. So, from when we are seeing just the diversity of the world, it's like we are blinded by the darkness. But when we see only the unity, that's like being blinded by the brightness. But when we become accustomed to that brightness, then we can say that in that brightness also there is variety. Absolute oneness doesn't mean that there is no subject or object of consciousness, there is only stream. Because there is nothing to reciprocate, there is nothing to bring joy to life. So absolute oneness means that there is no separateness of intention. There are no separate interests in anyone, there is only pure love. So I talked about emotions, two stories. One was, first I talked about example of the rose, you can see it analytically and aesthetically. So, emotions are important, but we should choose the emotions that lift us up and not drag us down. In the story of Ram and Lakshman. And then, in the realm of pure consciousness, there is variegatedness within oneness. There is one supreme and there are many subordinates. But the oneness of love is so great that both the supreme and the subordinate forget the supremacy of the supreme. And it is love that reigns supreme. I discuss the story of Krishna with the gopis, where the gopis' love causes them to look for Krishna beyond Vishnu. They forget Vishnu's godhood. And it causes Krishna to forget his own godhood when he reveals his own form unintentionally to Radharani. So the heart's deepest fulfillment comes, the head's fulfillment comes when we go beyond the illusory, temporary variety of this world to that which is eternal. And in that eternal world, the heart's fulfillment comes when we appreciate the reciprocation of love between the soul and the supreme. And their oneness is in the having there having no separate interest. They're being united in the reciprocation of love eternally. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions or comments? Yes, please. So what does Vasudeva Sarvam Iti mean? Is it pointing to love or is it pointing to anything else? See, basically, we can have two conceptions of God. As I said, one conception of God, there is one God, which is true. But that is not the only understanding God. There is only God. There is also another understanding. Let me explain this. Sometimes we think of God as the best of all beings. We have this much power, somebody has this much power, somebody has this much power. And God has a supreme power. But that is just one way of looking at God. If you know the pastime of Prahlad and Narasimha and Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyakashipu tries to kill Prahlad in various different ways. And he's not able to kill him at all. And finally, in exasperation, Hiranyakashipu asks Prahlad, "What is the source of your strength?" And at first glance, Prahlad's reply can simply seem cheeky. It's like somebody is angry and you're making them angry. He says, "The source of my strength is also the source of your strength. And is also the source of your strength." That means you have got your strength from Brahma by worshipping Brahma. So the source of my strength and your strength and Brahma, so this is one. And that is the supreme. So now, this is like somebody is angry and you are aggravating that person, it will seem like that. But if you see later, what he says, next verse is, that, "Oh Father, understand that in this world, you have no enemies. And Vishnu is not your enemy at all. He is the well-wisher of everyone. Your only enemy is your uncontrolled and misguided mind. Control that and you will live happily." So what is he trying to say? Hiranyakashipu over here has this conception that there is a hierarchy of beings and on top is God. So like say, if you have 100 tennis players. Somebody is ranked 100, somebody is ranked 80, somebody is ranked 10, somebody is 2, somebody is 1. Now if the player ranked 2 becomes good enough and wins more tournaments than the player one ranked 1, then he can displace the one who is at 1 and then become himself 1. So Hiranyakashipu is thinking like that. Yes, I am this much powerful, Brahma is this much powerful. But if I do austerities, if I grab power, then I can become, I can kill Vishnu. And basically after that, I will become the supreme. So he's telling him, you cannot do that. God is not just the best of all beings. God is the basis of all being. God is the basis of all being. That means nothing can exist without him. Yachapi sarva bhutana bijam tadaham arjuna na tadasti vina yatsyan maya bhutam characharam. Without me nothing could exist, Krishna says in 10.39 in the Gita. That means that actually whoever exists by the power of Krishna. And not only exists by the power of Krishna, whatever power anyone has, whatever ability anyone has, that ability and power are given to them by Krishna. But also they are also energies of Krishna. And in that sense, they are not separate from Krishna. So Vasudeva Sarvamiti means that at one level, we understand Vasudeva to be a person. So God is the best of all beings. That is one understanding of God. But that is not the only understanding of God. God is also the basis of all being. In the introduction to Nectar of Instruction, Nectar of Devotion, Prabhupada says that Krishna, the absolute truth, means he includes the material energy, the spiritual energy, he includes all living beings. So Krishna is not just one person in all of existence. Krishna is all of existence also. So now, of course, that doesn't mean that Krishna is not a person. Krishna is all of existence, and within existence, he also has the manifestation of the all-attractive absolute. So that is how, when we say Vasudeva Sarvamiti, at that point Krishna is telling Arjuna that if you look at the context of the verses, the previous verses 7.19, 7.16 talks about how there are different categories of people who come to me. Some people come for money, some people come for relief from distress, some people because they are inquisitive, and some people because they want knowledge. Krishna says, those who get knowledge, they understand that I am everything. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. That means that they understand that ultimately nothing exists separate from Vasudeva, and even I am not separate from Vasudeva. Now, if it would mean absolutely that Vasudeva Sarvamiti, then they would say the same verse, if this oneness were in a sense of absolute oneness, then that same verse what is it? Bahunam janmanam ante jnanavan mam prapadyate Vasudeva Sarvamiti samatma sudurlabha. So what does it mean? If Vasudeva itself is everything, is the absolute truth, then why does anyone have to surrender to anyone else? Because there's nothing existing only. But it is the surrender. So that now another example, when Prahlad tells Hiranyakashipu that Vishnu is existing everywhere. Where is your Vishnu? Is he in this pillar? Yes. He's everywhere, so he's in this pillar also. Then he breaks the pillar and Narasimhadev emerges from it. Now after Narasimhadev emerges and Narasimhadev delivers Hiranyakashipu, then Prahlad comes with a garland. Now Prahlad does not go and garland the pillar. He goes and garland Narasimhadev. If Vishnu is present everywhere, then why doesn't Prahlad go and garland the pillar? Why does he garland Narasimhadev? Because although everything is God, although God is present in everything, and in a sense everything is God, but still God has a personal manifestation with which we can reciprocate love. Srila Prabhupada says that, you know, God is everywhere, we can say sky is everywhere. But if I want to have personal relationship with the sky, what will I do? I look at the sky, what do I do with the sky? Oh sky, I love you. But what after that? We need a personal manifestation for reciprocating love. So, not only do we need it, the Supreme also is filled with love. The Supreme also wants to reciprocate love. So, there is the understanding of God as the basis of all being, that is talked about Vasudeva Sarvamiti. And that same Vasudeva who says, Vasudeva, Krishna is saying, I am everything, Vasudeva is everything. But he says, still, the wise surrender to me. They don't merge in me. They don't become one with me. All everything. So then what does it mean? What does oneness mean? Oneness there, that when we are in a pure state, we understand that we are actually not different from Krishna. That doesn't mean that we and Krishna are absolutely one. It simply means that our interest is not different from Krishna's interest. Our highest interest is served by loving Krishna. And that oneness is understanding that I am one with Krishna in love, and that is my eternal state. Does that answer your question? Resides in the sky, similarly all living beings reside in me. Yes, good example, yes. Any other questions or comments? Yes. Okay. Yeah, okay. So, if our emotions are dragging us down, at that time, what do we do? There are broadly two distinct paths. One is the path of jnana or yoga, where there is a cessation of material emotions. Just become detached. Just avoid all emotions. Give up all emotions, and then you will not be misled. And then after that, one can slowly come to the level of spiritual reality and discover spiritual emotions. So in yoga, in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, it is said that yogas chitta vritti nirodha. at the moment of consciousness that is happening at the material level, when that stops, that is when one has attained the stage of yoga. However, that same Yoga Sutra also is talking about Ishwara Pranidhan, surrendering to Ishwara. So who is that Ishwara? What is the nature of that relationship? So there is, so basically that means we could work in one ways, we just detach ourselves from worldly emotions and come to neutral state and then explore if there are some positive spiritual emotions. But in the path of bhakti, we understand that there are positive spiritual emotions and there are negative worldly emotions. So we want to strengthen the positive spiritual emotions. And the process of bhakti yoga, wherein we repeatedly expose ourselves to Krishna, to his holy name, through his deities, to his scriptures, this makes us more and more attached to Krishna. Abhyasa yogendra to mam ichchaptum dhananjaya. When we practice sadhana bhakti, we become more and more attached to him. And then the positive spiritual emotions start becoming more and more forceful. And then the negative emotions slowly disappear. However, while this is happening, in the intermediate period, when sometimes the negative emotions do pop up, at that time, we have to use our intelligence. Evam buddhe param buddhva samsthabhya atmanam atmana. So when I start feeling angry, at that time, okay, this anger is an unwanted emotion. So let me distance myself from it. And how do I do that? By not just by using my intelligence, but intelligence situated in transcendence. That means I use my intelligence not just to say no to the negative emotions. It is more to say yes to the positive emotions. So if I connect myself with Krishna, Krishna, please help me. Krishna, please guide me. And we find a channel for our consciousness to move towards Krishna. Then that negative emotion can be decreased. So sometimes it may be that first we take shelter of Krishna and then we get the intelligence. Dadami buddhi yogam tam. So depending on our situation, our consciousness, our nature, it may be that by intelligence we go towards transcendence, or sometimes we just take shelter of transcendence and then we get the intelligence, how to deal with the emotion. So it can work both ways. Okay? Thank you. Yes, Madhavi. So, the divisions in Sanatana Dharma's history of, say, one of Dvaita and Advaita, of Bhakti and impersonalist, these, when did they start? How did they historically develop? See, the Upanishads, they talk about the absolute truth in terms which are both personalist and impersonalist. The Ishopanishad talks about from the personalist point of view. There are other Upanishads which talk about from the impersonalist point of view. So the idea is that the Vedic texts, they offer what you could call as user-friendly spirituality. What that means is, whatever is the level of consciousness of the reader, accordingly you make spiritual advancement. So people who are very fried out with worldly relationships, worldly emotions, if you tell them in the spiritual world there are relationships, I don't want to go there. So then, for them, okay, spiritual world is a realm of oneness, of unity. That's what will attract them. And that is also given. So historically, both of these originate from the Vedic scriptures. And both of them are meant for the spiritual elevation of different people who are coming from different backgrounds. Now, at one particular time in Indian history, the... because there was so much casteism, discrimination against lower caste, there's so much other sub-religious ideas started percolating in, that because of the discrimination and other factors, many people rejected Hinduism and they either adopted Buddhism or Jainism. So from 5th century BCE to around 5th century AD, many parts of India were ruled by either Buddhists or Jain kings. So actually speaking, if you consider that area of classical, let's call classical Greek, classical age. So at that time, more books propagating atheism were written in Sanskrit than any other world language. not in Greek, not in Persian, not in anything. Because Buddhists and Jainism, these religions ideologically don't accept the existence of God. So at that time, around 6th century, Sripad Shankaracharya came. And his purpose was to unify the followers of the Sanatan Dharma and to bring back those who had gone off. So he presented, so Buddhism had the idea of there is what they call as Shunya. Shunya is voidism. Now voidism can have multiple understandings, what they mean by it. But their idea is that the absolute truth has, whatever exists, ultimately it has no attributes, it has no qualities, they call it Shunya. So then Shankaracharya, because that was the pervading conception of people at that time, so Shankaracharya presented at that time the teachings of the Upanishads, which talks about the Brahma. So he said that Buddha, the Buddhistic conception of Shunya and the conception of Brahma as drawn from the Upanishads by Shankaracharya, they were intellectual clones. Practically at an intellectual level similar. That's why he said, people, this is what you want, this is there in the Vedic Dharma also, why do you want to go out? And of course, it's always true that power corrupts. So Buddhism also had some issues that came up, Jainism also had some issues came up. So many people came back to the Vedic Dharma at that time. Now after Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya came. And Ramanujacharya said, so Shankara said, you know, okay, you want oneness, there's oneness here only. But then Ramanujacharya came and said, yes, there's oneness, but within the oneness also there is variety. So Shankaracharya taught Advaitavad, Ramanujacharya taught what you can say, Vishishta Advaita. There is oneness, but there is some qualified oneness, Vishishta. And what was that qualified oneness? His example was, the defining metaphor of Ramanujacharya was that, the relationship of the body, of the soul and the body. So he said, the universe is the body and Vishnu is the soul. So at one level we can say that the body and the soul are different. But at another level, the body acts according to the will of the soul. So similarly, all living beings are meant to act according to the will of Vishnu. And when they act according to the will of Vishnu, then there is harmony and there is happiness. So yes, there is oneness, but what is the nature of that oneness? There is oneness of harmony. And then, so if you consider a pendulum, Shankaracharya presented oneness. Vishishta Advaita said, yes, oneness, but there's variety in it. Then Madhvacharya came. And Madhvacharya said, actually, what oneness? Dvaita. He says, where do you see oneness? He says, you look at one particle of matter and another particle of matter. Even one leaf and another leaf, there are differences. So you talk about Panchamabhed. There are basically three tattvas in nature. You could say matter, consciousness, and the infinite, and the supreme. So we can, in Sanskrit, we can call it as Jagat, Jeev, and Jagadish. So in the Jagat, there's variety among different particles. In the Jeeva, each Jeeva is different. So there's difference between matter and matter, there's difference between Jeeva and Jeeva, there's difference between matter and Jeeva, there's difference between Jeeva and Ishvara, and there's difference between matter and Ishvara. So there's Pancham Ved. So he took the pendulum to the other side. And then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, yes, there is oneness, but there is also the relationship within the one. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught what is called Achintya Bheda Abhed. So Bheda and Abhed. There is oneness and there is difference also. But how both of them are working, there is Achintya, that is inconceivable. So he brought the pendulum back down, back to the middle balanced state. So you could say that Shankara, Buddha, if you see, he symbolized with Shunya, not like this. He's just showing Shunya. That means Shunya, everything, absolute truth is zero. Shankara is symbolized with one. Everything is one. Madhvacharya is symbolized with two. It's duality, there's two. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is symbolized with both hands upraised. So there is two-ness, but there is a joyful, ecstatic relationship between the two. With hands upraised, he symbolizes dancing, he's depicted as dancing. So that is the, we could say, the holistic understanding, where the oneness and the two-ness are harmonized, I understand that there is oneness in the nature, everyone is spiritual, oneness in belonging, because we are all ultimately the part of the absolute truth. At the same time, there is two-ness in the sense that there is a reciprocation of love. Okay?
Okay.
You have some comments or questions? Okay. Good question. Do we have free will or don't we have free will? Well, to answer this question, I'll have to assume that I have the free will to answer this question.
Okay. Okay, I'll come to that. Yes, good point.
So, is your question that do we have free will in the sense that if God is omniscient, is God acting through everyone? Is that the way you qualified the question is that, is your question that if God is supreme, that how do we have free will? If God is controlling everyone, then how do we have free will?
God is the cause of all causes.
Okay.
God is everything.
Then how do we have free will?
Then how do we have free will?
Okay, good question. So if God is everything, God is the cause of everything, then how do we have free will? See, God is the cause of all causes, but he is not the cause of all effects. What do I mean by this? See, if any vegetation grows on the earth, the rain is the cause of the vegetation. Without the rain, no vegetation will grow. But which vegetation grows where, that is not determined by the rains. That is determined by what kind of seeds are where. Some places crops may grow, some places fruits may grow, some places weeds may grow, some places just grass may grow. So that the rain is the cause of the growth of all vegetation. Without the rain, nothing will grow. But the rain is not the cause of which specific vegetation grows where. Nādatte kasacit papam na caiva sukrutam vibho ajñānena āvrutam jñānam tena muhyanti jantavaha. And 5.14, the Bhagavata Krishna says, I do not accept the pious or the sinful activities of anyone. They act deluded by ignorance. Svabhavastu pravartate jnanena tajnanam yesham nashitam atmana tesham adityavas jnanam prakashati tatparam. When that ajnana is removed, then they act in the light of knowledge. So, God is supreme and he is the ultimate reality, as I say, the cause of all causes. At the same time, by his arrangement, he has given all of us free will so that we can have reciprocation of love, so that there can be the bhakti. You know, if a boy goes very affectionately to a girl and he offers her a rose, please marry me, and she says no, and immediately takes out a gun, marry me. I say, where is the love over here, isn't it? So if there is force, then there can be no love. If the boy is not giving the girl the choice whether to love her or not, then that is not love at all. So Krishna is omnipotent. He is supreme, but he has given all of us free will so that we can reciprocate love. Now, how can our free will exist with his omnipotence, with his supremacy? For that, the example is the verse 9.6. Yatha akasha svito nityam vayu sarvatra gomahan tatha sarvani bhutani matsthanitya upadharaya. That just as the wind flows within the sky, similarly all living beings reside within me. Now if you conceive of the sky like an upside down bowl, then the air's flow is not limited by the sky. The air can move up, it can move down, it can move left, it can move right. What is limited is the area of movement. The air's movement itself is not limited. The air's area of movement is limited by the sky. So similarly for all of us, so God's controllership is like the sky. And within that, we can move about. So we have free will. You could say we have unlimited free will within a limited framework. The sky, the air can move left, right, northeast, southwest, any direction. It is quite free, but within a limited framework. So for us, say as human beings, you know, right now we are talking, you know, each of us can choose to talk. We can talk sense, we can talk nonsense, we can speak good words, we can speak foul words, we can choose to remain silent. We have that free will. But we can't, say, sing like a parrot. We can't communicate through sounds the way animals communicate. That is a limit that we have. So by the body that we have got, by the arrangement of the Lord, that body limits us. So we can say unlimited freedom within a limited framework. Like if a horse is tied by a rope to a pole. Now, it cannot go beyond the radius of the rope. But within that radius, it can run around, it can stand, it can move back, move forward, it can do various things. So our free will exists by the arrangement of the Lord. And the way our free will and God's omniscience or omnipotence, God's supreme will is reconciled is that by God's will, the scope of our free will is limited. Now, different people have different scopes for their free will. An ant can just move along a small ground. And it's tiny being. If a tree comes in the way, the ant has to find a way aside. There's a giant elephant. If the tree comes in the way, the elephant may knock down the tree also. So it has been given a big enough body by which it can have greater influence. The ant has a small body. So similarly, even human form also, some people, they are very charismatic, very commanding presence. They can influence hundreds of people. Others, they may be unassuming, they may not be able to, they may be withdrawn, and they may influence just a few people around them. That is the sphere of influence that we have is called in the Bhagavad Gita, Kshetra. Kshetra. Prakriti refers to general material nature. Kshetra refers to the specific area of material nature over which we have been given control. And this Kshetra is determined by our past karma. So people who have done punya in their past life, in this life they will have a large Kshetra. They may have a lot of money, they may have a lot of intelligence, they may have a lot of popularity, whatever. And when that karma runs out, then their Kshetra shrinks. So somebody may be a famous cricketer and then millions of people are their fans. But after they retire and then they can't play well, then the number of people who admire them go down substantially. So the popularity which they had one time, that goes down. So the Bhagavad Gita says that actually we have free will, but we are not absolutely free. There are two ideas. One is that we have no will, or we have no free will, or we have absolute free will. So we don't have absolute free will. We are definitely controlled. But we are not absolutely controlled also. At the end of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna acknowledges Arjuna's independence and appeals to Arjuna's intelligence. In 18.63 he says, Vimrishaitad asheshena yathechasi tatha kuru. Now Arjuna, deliberate deeply on what I have said and then decide what you want to do. So deliberate deeply means he's appealing to the intelligence, and then do as you desire. That means he's acknowledging his independence and choose how you want to act. And Arjuna, he says that with my intelligence, I decide to harmonize with you. 10 verses later in 18.73 he says, Karishye vachinam tava, I will do your will. So the free will that we have is scope. It can get, as I said, decreased or increased, not just by the karma that we have done in the previous life, even in this life. In this life, when we form certain habits. What does habit mean? See, for us, say some impulse comes in front of us. And then there's a response from us. There's a reaction. So normally, if somebody offers us some food, we evaluate. Am I hungry? Is this fatty food? Should I eat it or not eat it? Should I eat it later? We'll evaluate that. But Suppose somebody is hooked to someone, somebody is an alcoholic. As soon as they see an alcohol bottle, they just have to pick it up and drink it. For them, the space between the impulse and the response has become so little that it's almost as if not there. So there's a British playwright, Mark Twain, he said that giving up smoking is the easiest thing in the world. I have done it over 100 times. So I gave up smoking, but smoking did not give me up. Because what happened at that time is I'm not going to smoke. But next time the impulse comes, immediately the response comes is smoke. So basically, from this perspective, we can say that the greater the distance between the impulse and the response, greater is our free will. But the more we keep doing a particular activity, the more it becomes habitual. And when it becomes habitual, that means the distance between impulse and response becomes lesser and lesser and lesser, till it appears as if the two are just tied together. So in this life also, by the way we act, we can actually decrease the scope of our free will, or we can increase the scope of our free will. Does that answer your question?
So, on this planet Earth, that particular seed, being at that particular place, at that particular time, is the cause of Krishna.
It's caused by Krishna. Okay.
Otherwise, he cannot know the future. So, he knows the future only by knowing the cause of all causes and a systematic development of everything, including the thoughts of a being, which are rooted in Maya to those who are not understanding by karma.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as you can understand that I am in Maya thinking I have free will, and then you surrender to God saying I don't have free will, you are everything, you are the cause of everything, you are enlightened, and you are Jiva Mukta. Till your karma finishes, and then you transcend to Him.
Thank you. So is it that if anything is at a particular place, the seed being a particular place, weed being a particular place, that is arranged by Krishna. So to think that we have free will is Maya. To understand that we have no free will and to surrender to Krishna, that is what takes us out of Maya? Yes. If you see in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna does say this, what you are saying. He says in 18.5960, that Arjuna, you are going to bound to act according to your nature. So, bhava jena kaunte nibaddha svena karmana. That you have to act according to your nature. And you cannot avoid that. And therefore, he says, surrender to me. Tam eva sharanam gacha sarva bhavena bhava. So, 18.5960, then 18.62 is surrender to the Supreme. But then, after telling surrender to the Supreme, he says, now decide what you want to do. So, what does this mean? Let me complete this, then you can come back. See, there is a difference between free will and freedom. Sometimes you may equate the two things. Free will and freedom. Even a prisoner has free will. But the prisoner does not have freedom. The prisoner is in a restricted situation where the prisoner does not have freedom. And if the prisoner in the jail starts fighting, if the prisoner in the jail imagines that I am free and tries to go out of the jail, be caught and be punished. If he tries to break through the jail, he'll get into bigger trouble. So, freedom and free will are two distinct things. So, what we don't have in the material world, as long as we're in Maya, is freedom. Even to say to Krishna that I don't have any free will, that is an act of free will. If you are saying to Krishna I have no free will, and I am saying to Krishna I have free will, both cases it's an act of free will. It's like somebody says, I don't know even one word of English. Well, you already know 7 words of English. To say, I don't know even one word of English, that is what in English called as a self-contradictory statement. That means the very statement proves it is not true. So another self-contradictory experiment could be that I don't exist. Well, I have to exist to say I don't exist. If I don't exist, I will not be able to say also I don't exist. So what you are saying is true. But it applies not to free will, to freedom. If we imagine that we have freedom in this world, we simply get ourselves into more and more trouble. If we think that we can live independent of God, that will only cause us greater and greater misery. So the illusion of the freedom is the cause of our greater and greater bondage. So we don't have freedom in the sense that if we don't surrender to Krishna, we will be caught by Maya and will be dragged into deeper and deeper illusion. At the same time, it is for us to choose whether I want to stay in Maya or whether I want to go to Krishna. So that choice, to make that choice also requires some amount of free will. If I don't have free will, then how will I even say to Krishna that I don't have free will? If I say I don't have consciousness, well, an unconscious object cannot say I don't have consciousness. So the very denial of consciousness is an act that asserts the existence of consciousness. Similarly, the denial of free will is an act which indicates the presence of free will. So if we understand this difference between free will and freedom, then we fully agree that we don't have freedom. We have in the material world only the illusion of freedom. And those who think that they are free, they are actually more and more bound. Some are like this person, I can give up alcohol whenever, I can give up smoking whenever I want. But whenever the desire strikes, the person goes back to smoking. They don't have freedom. Now they have free will whether when the next time the urge comes, should I drink or not. If they are going to go into association where everybody is drinking, they will drink. But if they don't go into that association, there is a good chance that they may not drink. So the illusion of freedom causes bondage. And we need to understand that we cannot actually have freedom without God. But to understand that and to change that situation also requires free will. So free will is what the Bhagavad Gita guides us to use properly. All Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Baldev Vidya Bhushan, all these Vedantic commentators, they make this point that Shastra guides us. Do this and don't do this. Now, if we were purely programmed machines with no free will, then there is no point to tell us do this and don't do this. Because we have no choice at all. A machine is going to work the way it is programmed. There is no need for a scripture at all. The very presence of scripture which tells us, do this, don't do this, that presumes the existence, that presumes that in the receiver of scripture, there is some capacity to choose. So even Krishna is speaking the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is telling Arjuna to surrender to Krishna. Of what use would that be if Arjuna did not have the free will to surrender? So yes, freedom we don't have. Free will we do have.
Free will and freedom cause. Limited freedom cause.
Yes, agreed.
Everything is Krishna. So now, if you take this back, then you will see that the cause of everything is
Now,
take over that, for that individual. So for that, individual, perceive, he has free will, but cause is all Krishna. When Krishna has decided, Brahma creates your jarm, which has written what will happen. When he has decided, he will gain this knowledge, by which he will come out of illusion, then you will do so. So Arjuna was in Maya before the Gita, no matter how learned he was, because it is an example to all of us.
We are in Maya.
How to get out of Maya? Now only so many people are here today.
Some are not interested.
For those that are interested, he has said,
you now shall ascend.
Transcend out of here in some like this next, but not very far.
But others, you shall remain and do work according to the program I have created.
And you shall imagine you have freedom.
And you shall not be happy.
Actually, the moment you say,
I am not free.
I have no freedom.
Krishna is doing everything.
You are completely devoid of any negative illusion.
You are happy. Because
what do I have to suffer?
What do I have to gain?
It's Krishna
only. So I am Jivan Mukta.
Yes, if you can just complete this. That response, actually, we say Krishna knows the future. Krishna has ordained the trajectory of life for all living beings. When he wants, people will come back to him. And that the thing that we have free will is an illusion. Yeah, I would say that there are three distinct factors in the way we act. There is God's will, there is free will, and there is evil. So now, if God has programmed everyone to act in a particular way, then that would mean that God is responsible for everyone's suffering. That would make God a terrible sadist. It's people act in terrible ways in this world. Then it's like some people smoke, some people drink, some people do terribly self-hurting habits. So it's like a mother who has a child, and the mother makes the child beat its head against a wall, bleeding bitterly. So if everything that has happened is ordained by Krishna, then he is responsible for all the suffering. And that would make God not merciful, but heartless. Heartlessly cruel, utterly sadistic, who gets pleasures in other suffering. Not only that, there are different people who act in different ways. People act in brutal, unspeakable ways. So all those actions which are done by different people are also done by God. That would mean that God not only does things which make people hurt themselves, God also makes people do things that hurt others. So there is no meaning to karma, because what is bad karma is also done by God. So it is God is making me do bad things, and then God is making me suffer for doing those bad things. So that becomes, such a person is not God, such a person is Shaitan. Such a person is the worst demon that any living being can imagine. And the world would be better off without believing in such a God. So that is not Krishna is Surudam Sarva Bhutana. If we consider logical implications of seeing that God is the doer of everything. See, God is the doer of everything in the sense that he is the sanctioner of everything. But he is not the impeller of everything. If somebody wants to do something, if that person has the karmic endowment to do that, God allows him to do that. I'll give you an example from the Mahabharata, that Duryodhana wanted to fight the war, and Krishna himself went as Shantidut don't fight the world. Krishna offered him peace on the most accommodating terms. Now, Duryodhana refused. Krishna is God, Duryodhana is just one soul. Krishna appealed to the intelligence, appealed to the common sense. But Duryodhana did not listen. And the result was, then Krishna told him, if you're not really going to listen, Krishna offered him, he told him, just give 5 villages. But Duryodhana did not listen to that also. So here, Krishna himself is appealing to Duryodhana. So Krishna is telling Duryodhana, don't do something. So is Krishna having a perverse sense of drama where he tells him, don't do it? He's actually, if you see, Krishna is a Sam, Dam, Bhed and Dand. Everything to try to persuade Duryodhana to not fight the war. And yet Duryodhana fights the war. So what is the point of Krishna appealing to Duryodhana? If he is only making Duryodhana do everything, then, as I said, the idea that God is responsible for all the unspeakable atrocities that happen in the world, that makes God into the worst demon that a human being can imagine. So God is the sanctioner of what the human beings want to do. If the human beings have the karma to do that. Hitler had the karma by which he would have become extremely powerful. But he used that power to kill millions of people. He could have used that power to administer over a kingdom and do good to others also. So God, he sees, he's present in our hearts and he sees our desires, and based on whether we deserve, he allows that desire to be fulfilled. So yes, we could say the seed is present at a particular place by God's arrangement. The weeds are present in another place by God's arrangement. But when we talk about God's arrangement, there are two things in it. There is God's plan and there is God's purpose. So, if there is a school, in that school there is an exam. And some students fail in the exam. Some students pass in the exam. Now the school's plan includes both. The student fails, okay, there's an arrangement. You know, you can appear for the exam again, you can do this course again, and you can move onwards. So the students failing or passing, both are included in the purview of the school's plan. But the student's failing is not the purpose of the school. The purpose of the school is the student's education, student's elevation to the next standard. So, we could say students passing, students failing, everything is within the arrangement of the school. But that is not, the student's failing is not the intention of the school. So, there is a difference between God's plan and God's purpose. So, even when Duryodhana acts in an evil way, that is within the purview of Krishna's plan. That means Krishna's plan is so inclusive and dynamic that even if a person acts in the wrong way, teachers want the student to pass, the school wants the student to go to a higher grade. But if the student fails, the school has the plan to accommodate them and help them move on. So similarly, Krishna's plan includes different living beings choosing differently and getting the consequences accordingly. But Krishna's purpose is like the school's purpose, to elevate the students to higher and higher level. So similarly, Krishna's purpose is that we all make wise choices, we all renounce the illusion of freedom, we all use our free will to harmonize with his will. And thus, we unite with him in pure love. The idea of individuality and the idea of separateness, they are two different things. I would say both of us are talking about the same thing, but we are just coming from different frameworks. The idea that we are separate living beings who can do whatever we want, whenever we want, the idea of absolute separateness is an illusion. The idea of individuality, in the sense that we have to choose to acknowledge that I don't have freedom, that is something which we have to do on our own. So everything that happens is Krishna's arrangement. But that doesn't mean everything that happens is what Krishna wants it to happen. That way. The school doesn't want the students to fail. But if the students fail, the school accommodates that. So it's not when we say God knows the future. That does not mean that every one of us is a programmed being who is meant to act accordingly. The whole idea of future, let's take it and I'll give two examples to illustrate this. You know the well-known story of when Krishna's appearances is forecast. At that time, Kamsa is driving the chariot of Devaki after she is just married. And then he hears the Akashvani saying that, oh, the eighth child of Devaki will kill you. Now that Kamsa becomes so angry, so fearful, that he catches the hair of Devaki and is about to lop off her head. At that time, Vasudeva tries to protect his wife by using various strategies. One of the strategies he uses at that time is, he says, oh Kamsa, life and death are destined. And nobody can change destiny. So, why are you doing this terribly sinful activity of killing a woman, killing your own sister, killing your own sister on her wedding day? This is like you can say sin square and sin cube. It's a terribly sinful activity. Why are you doing that to avoid something which, if it is destined, is going to happen? Now, at this point, Vasudev could have turned the reasoning around and he could have thought that if Devaki's death is destined, then what am I doing trying to stop Kamsa? Why am I trying to stop Kamsa at all? Because the Vedic culture, the Vedic wisdom is not destiny-centered. It is duty-centered. It is, all of us have a particular duty to do. And Kamsa was, as a Kshatriya, he had a duty to protect, but he was giving up his duty. So he was told, there's destiny. Don't give up your duty to avoid something. If it's destined, it is going to happen. Whereas for Vasudev, his duty was, I have to protect my wife. So even if her death is destined, that's fine. That's not fine with me. That will happen. But I have to do my duty to protect her. So I would say that destiny is a whole different subject. Destiny refers to that which is ordained. But broadly speaking, what is ordained? What is ordained is certain events in our life are ordained. Destiny is like a weather forecast. It's forecast that, okay, today it's going to be cold, today it's going to rain, today it's going to snow. Now, none of us can change. If it's going to snow, it's going to snow. But what we do, that's up to us. I can go out into the snow and I'll get frozen without any preparation. I'll get frozen. I can stay at home, I'll be protected. Or I can go out with protection and I may not be so much damaged. So destiny determines what happens to us. Destiny doesn't determine how we respond. Destiny doesn't determine our actions. It determines our situations. The situations that we encounter in our life journey, they are determined by destiny. The actions that we choose in those situations are up to us. So when Krishna says he knows the future, what that essentially means is that he knows the various trajectories, the various options. It's like there's a big road map. So I can only see the road here. Okay, I can see the straight road, or I can see this fork. But somebody who has the whole picture, they can say, if you take this road, you are going to meet big traffic over there. You're going to be blocked. If you take this road, you're not going to see the traffic and go clearly. So Krishna can see the whole map. Krishna can see the whole map. In that sense, he knows everything. But when we come to a fork, it is up to us to choose. God's knowledge of the future is like our knowledge of the past. I repeat, God's knowledge of the future is like our knowledge of the past. Our knowledge of the past is knowledge without intervention. I know, I woke up and I did this. Yesterday I did that. So I know that, but there is no intervention. Now for us, we can't do any intervention. For God, he can do intervention, but he chooses not to do it. So God's knowledge of the future, if you want to say that if God knows the future, then there would be, if God knows the future in the absolute sense, in the sense that everything, every single thing about the future he knows, then there would be a contradiction in the definition of God itself. Why? Because there are two defining attributes of God. God, he can do anything and he knows everything. Omnipotence and omniscience. So now, if he knows the future in the sense that the whole future is mapped out completely, then does he have the power to change the future?
So God's knowledge of the future,
if he has the power to change the future, that means he doesn't know the future. If he knows the future and the future is completely mapped out, that means he doesn't have the power to change the future.
Every single thing about the future.
So this is one of the standard atheistic arguments which they use. They said that the very definition of God is self-contradictory.
Because
the two defining attributes, that he knows everything and he can do anything. These two are contradictory.
And he knows everything.
But the fundamental understanding is that God is omnipotence, is omniscience. These are not attributes that he's stuck with. It's like somebody is a very tall person. Now, they're stuck with their tallness. They're still stuck with their tallness and they have to come out and they have to go from there. So God is omnipotent, God is omniscient. But he's not stuck with his potence, he's not stuck with his omniscience. Ultimately, underlying all his attributes is his loving nature. That is his omnibenevolence. Omnibenevolence means he wants the good for everyone. And for serving for fulfilling his omnibenevolent nature, sometimes he may manifest his omnipotence. And sometimes he may manifest his omniscience. So, when he is on the Kurukshetra war field, at that time, he tells Arjuna that if you don't fight this war, by my arrangement, the enemies are already killed. But you become an instrument. And then you will get the credit. So he's giving two options. Arjuna, you have to choose. If you become my instrument, I will act through you and you will get the glory. Nimitta matram bhava savya sachi. But if you don't do that, rutte pitvamna bhavishyanti sarve. Even without you, they'll be killed. So the choice, his omnipotence is that he can do whatever he wants. But he gives us the free will to choose how we act. And if we use our free will properly, then he accommodates things so that we get benefited by that. So God's omnipotence and his omniscience, they are harmonized by his omnibenevolence. So it is his omnibenevolence that is absolute, and his omnipotence and his omniscience are used to serve the purpose of his omnibenevolence. So God is our greatest well-wisher, and he wants the very best happiness, the very best joy for us. He doesn't want, and he certainly won't make us do the things which will bring suffering upon us. He wants only that which is best for us. But if we make certain choices which will bring suffering upon us, he includes those choices within his plan, and he keeps him as like we have plan. A good manager has plan A, plan B, plan C, plan D. So like that, Krishna has many plans, and he knows which choice will take us into which plan. Whichever choice we make, Krishna will accommodate that choice within his ultimate purpose of getting us back to him. But if I take the right road, I'll get to the decision immediately. If I take a wrong road, still, my Google map is flexible enough. It will tell, now turn left. Now do this. Even if I take another wrong turn, still Google map, now you do this. If I still take a wrong turn, still it will tell me. Now that means, however many wrong turns I take, Google map is there to guide me to the right destination. But the more wrong turns I take, the longer it will take me to get to the destination. So there is a plan which includes all my wrong choices. But the purpose is not that I make the wrong choices. So in that sense, everything is known to Krishna. That whichever path, wherever I go, Krishna will adjust his plan and give me a way to come from there back to him. But that doesn't mean whichever choice I take is determined by him. He knows the connection between choices and consequences. And if you take this choice, this will have this consequence. And from there, to come back, you have to take this choice. But if from there also you take this choice, you'll go here. From there to come here, you'll have this choice. So Krishna has the whole map mapped out so that whichever choice we make, still he will be there to give us a path to come to him. So in that sense, the future is ordained. That the various choices which may happen, what consequences may happen by that, that's mapped out. But within that, which choice we take, that is up to us. We can talk one to one of Silta.
Yeah, I don't want to debate this anymore. Only two things to think about. Ravan and his coming from being the guard down here. And the cause and the reason for Ram to come, everything ordained, everything happened. The only evil is not really evil because it's not affecting the reality of you and I, which is the jiva, which is unaffected. This is only a movie that is happening. Think of it that way.
Yes, agreed. Agreed.
It's taking place with karma.
Yes.
The second aspect, that is a very important verse in the Gita, and I don't know Sanskrit, so
yeah.
I speak only the English translation of what I understand.
Yeah.
God says to Arjuna, see here everything in the past, present and future, right before you. And I end with that. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Shri Krishna Bhagwan ki. Thay Gaur Premanande.